almost streaming. Oh, we are streaming live on YouTube. It is July the 10th, maybe, 2014. We are coming out of British Columbia. We usually stream. We had a little break where we got all new gear and we got all new issues up there. And that's me lucky charm up there hanging out to make sure that everything goes good for me. And what you're looking at is St. Paddy's Day. And ain't that a pretty one? And that's the wrong one. First off, Japan had an earthquake. That's not the one. I'll get it one of these days. Japan had an earthquake. And then it had a tsunami. And I shouldn't have to tell you this, but I'm going to tell you because some people can't get the picture. And here's the picture. The earthquake picked the ground up and smashed everything. That's what it done originally. There was 14 plants. And by the way, hi everybody. I'm going to get over to you if I can ever solve the issues I got. You wouldn't believe the last 10 minutes. Frantic. Hang on a second. I'm not even on the event. I don't even know if I'm streaming. I got to pop over here. Am I streaming? You open up that other window, right? And you'll see if I'm streaming there. Which one did I go to? On the second one from the left. Top. Very top. Very top. Very top of the page. Yeah, come one more towards the window. Yeah.
Fukushima, the desk?
Yeah. Each one of them are tabs here. And, okay, hang on. I'll get over here. And so you see the damage in that picture. I'll get going, folks. It usually takes me 5 minutes to get going. We usually stream for an hour. You're going to have some issues because I never got all the lights hung up yet. And we only got one coat on the wall. And there's just so many things we got to conquer before I can get it all to work. Hi, Sean. Irina Rell, Piano, Yusit, Don B, Tracy, Roosevelt, Sean, Can Serve, Sterilite, Mass Sterilization. I gotta turn my speaker, my audio down. I'm getting fancy, Cats Alive. Mr. I Can See, Stacy. Hi, Stacy Lane, 74. Cats Alive, Toxic. Illusion is over. Broken Ass Honor, Tracy May, so nice to see you folks again. Ronald McKnight, I'm on track already, just like that. Piano the Precious, Stacy, Elaine, Albert, France, Standing Foot. Hey, bud, thank you. Missing Sky, I like what you're doing. Thank you again, folks. It's been a very odd couple of days, and I can't share that right now, but it's all good, really good. And we've been working so hard just to get up and running. Something else. So let's get on with it. And tonight I will come in after and read everybody's comments and get back into my mode because that helps me get into my mode. I don't tell you that because I don't want it to go to your heads, but I actually get back into my mode. Or is it vice versa? It goes to my head. We'll never know because I ain't talking. So it looks good. What you're seeing is an earthquake. Think about that. That's a huge, massive earthquake. And that earthquake unleashed hell up on the poor people at Fukushima. And it started with detonations of 3 reactors. Now, when you take that into consideration, just one reactor is many times worse than Chernobyl. And if you're not familiar with Chernobyl, they evacuated 8,500 square miles. And so 3,500 square miles. To Chechnya River, they evacuated 7,500 people and 9,000 square miles, and a decade later they evacuated another 1,000 square miles because of the storage tanks detonated, because all the heavy elements, right, and sludge that they put in there get to the bottom, and you have all these cocktails of man-made radioactive materials and what they know as isotopes. And an isotope is what we call radioactive material. It's a radioactive atom. And in the atom is the isotope. But you also can have radioactive particles. And so when that building in the background, that's number 3, is detonating. And by the way, this is what it looked like when it blew up. But the Senate hearing a month ago with the NRC, an update on Fukushima and other pertinent nuclear catastrophic events that they're not going to tell you about, but they cover up really well. Well, that building there was 2 million times worse than any other reactor on the planet. And so you have to excuse any kind of pixeling going on in the green screen, but that reactor is 2 million times worse. And so I just want to get everybody back into the context again. I'm not going to go too bling bling on everybody. You're not going to see me with some fancy desk or some fancy background very much. I don't know if I'll ever use it. It'll probably never see it on YouTube because I'm not that kind of guy. I like to keep it simple. Now, when you think about the tsunami, it went back out. And you think about it, you got a couple of billion tons of radioactive material in Japan. And what they're doing is they're burning that. And you have to think about the Trans-Pacific pollution. And so just a quick jump for anybody that's not familiar with this stuff, is that pollution for automobiles in Asia, for instance, has been studied. And these are big particles. And the pollution, say, from forest fires in Asia, these have been studied. And how these particles of pollution from automobiles and cities and forest fires have been studied to hell because they come across the Trans-Pacific airstreams and they're great big particles and they add to your index of pollution sustaining where they linger over America and Canada, North America for months at a time before a weather front moves in and moves us somewhere else. Now, radioactive particles compared to these, radioactive particles are 1,000, say, to be generous, 1,000 of the size of the automobile pollution or the forest fire pollution, probably 1/10,000 the size of those types of pollutions. Now, you know, you can put a million radioactive atoms on the head of a needle. Each one of those atoms, if you ingest a single one of them, is like getting an x-ray 1,440 minutes a day. And we had snowstorms that inundated the coastline of Canada. And let me just touch on that for everybody. Federal training manual refers to sick and nuclear workers as Freddy Cougars. September 27, 2011. And that's disgusting, isn't it? Because the next month, they had a massive accident at Fukushima. Now, hopefully I'll get on track this time. Oh, I'm getting there, okay. I just want to bring in another headline for everybody. Health Canada calls 300 times background levels of iodine 131 minute. Terry, can you give me that big chummy on the bottom of the table, the calculator?
Yes, I will.
I got a real calculator. I'll put some numbers on. They try to give you some perspectives instead of me doing it here. And you can't see it. We decided you either go big or you don't go anywhere. So we got something now that spits out numbers. Alrighty, 300 times background level of iodine, 131. You got to realize there's 10 times more iodine, 133. And I'm sure if there's anybody yelling at me, because I'm going to check before it starts that, make sure nobody's yelling at me. And I needed someone to help me tonight to manage this, and we just barely pulled it off. So Terry hung around. It's a good thing, Terry. But anyway, nobody's yelling at me. Everything looks good. I look small. I apologize. I was born that way. There's nothing I can do about it. So I just wanted to give one number in perspective for anybody who's not familiar with how this works. And I suppose you probably can't hear me. But let's keep going. So 300 times background. Well, background is 70, and you probably can't see it, but hang on, 7,500. You see those numbers? Probably not. We got to get a better camera so you can see those numbers. 7,500. I'm not going to hide anything. I'm going to times. Now, that's background radiation to 7,500. That's what you get in a glass of water. It's considered homeostasis. And I can't show you all the bells and whistles tonight, because I haven't got it imported yet, but make no mistake, it'll be relentless for the next 2 weeks. By the way, 7,500, that's where we left off. Now times 300, and I got a little big old times there, times 300 equals some big ass numbers, 2.2 something, ooh, hang on, 2 million. Okay, what there was 10 times more iodine 132. I don't just add another zero. there was 30 times more iodine-133. Iodine-122, by the way, it ionizes your thyroid gland 9 times more effective. And that's why that's a factor. And that's why you got to pull people's heads out of their butts. Because talking about iodine-131, mining, you know, 300 times background levels. Now, to put it in the context, if you put that in a glass of water and drink it, you're dead human walking, or dead pet walking, or dead budgie bird walking, because you're getting an x-ray for each atom every minute, 1,440 x-rays a day with just one radioactive atom. But I want you to remember that it's not just the stuff that was in the building, but when the building is cannibalized, right, set fire to and everything else. How's the stream going, everybody? Looks good. That building, as it falls in on the melted cores and becomes aerosol and atomized, that's radioactive particles. That's just as bad as ingesting a hot atom, which everybody in North America did in March from these accidents. So I got a couple more I want to cover for you. Now, the next one was a study where Health Canada flew along the coastline of British Columbia, where I'm told, right along the coastline on March the 18th and the 19th. And there was evidence of sharp features in the Fukushima plume over southwestern British Columbia. Do you think they just like made that up? Oh, by the way, that number, you got to multiply it by 99 to get how much strontium-90 traveled along with all of this too. Because whatever showed up in iodine, there was probably more cesium-137. And cesium-137 is a signature for strontium, not for anything else. Cesium-137 is garbage as far as I'm concerned, compared to there's 99 times more strontium. So you keep getting fed those numbers about that cesium and iodine. Think about the iodine-132, iodine-133. For every 4 iodine-131s created, the fourth one's an iodine-129 with a 15 million year half-life. And so we should be looking for that one because that's the signature. But like your Geiger counters can't find jack shit. What they sure are scared is the daylights out of somebody. If you don't know what you're doing, you got to know how not to excite these. Right, there's so many flaws with these things. Even though when you see more than one people in an area getting high numbers, say, you know, 3 and 4 different people, that somebody got it right. And these are not looking for any really stuff that's coming from Fukushima in the sense of what's really coming out of there, like the uranium and the plutonium and all their daughters that came out of there and blanketed North America. Hang on, I'll keep on track. Evidence of sharp features with my big gecko. Hang on, because that'll come in handy once I get used to doing it. Now, I want you to think about that headline. It says, Fukushima plume. That's from the government, Health Canada. They flew along the coastline. Let's go up with another one of that. I don't even know where I'm to sometimes. So, listen to this. This is from Health Canada. March 18, March 19, they flew along the coastline for 18 hours at 750 feet, taking samples. And I'll show you that, where they took the samples. They were pretty proud of themselves. They didn't hide it from anybody. But let me come back and cover that one more time. And now, Terry, you'll be getting a delay over there on what I'm saying and what's showing up. Yeah, several studies of radioactive releases. Did I even click, folks? Several studies of radioactive releases for Fukushima nuclear power plant already exist. Now, this was March the 20th at 1800 to 1900 the next day. And they flew along the coastline. They found a snowstorm, an invisible snowstorm along the entire coastline. This is their Health Canada's information. And they didn't tell the Canadians. They're like, the Canadians. The Canadians don't need to know. March the 20th, it was a blinding snowstorm. If you could see it visibly, you wouldn't be able to see each other. You wouldn't be able to drive down the highway. Of radioactive particles in California was 1,500 atoms in a cubic meter of air. Think about a cubic meter of air. Cubic meter of space where your kid stands up and waits for the bus, right? Where they got an umbrella in the rain. And they had snowstorms that lingered over Canada and the United States for months. But it didn't stop coming out of there until November. It happened March 11, 2011. But in 2011, in November, so April, May, June, July, August, September, November, it still didn't stop coming out of there. Let me give you an actual, I know it's hard for a lot of people to wrap their mind around it, and that's understandable, because there's nothing simple about this. And I'll come back to that one in a second. This is the NOAA model, the yellow one, and the one on the right is, it's American government anyway, agency. What? Is that NOAA too, I think? But anyway, it's a well-known model, 137. So there was 99 or 100 times more strontium-90. They didn't include the iodine. And if they did, they didn't include the 132 10 times more. They didn't include the 133 10 times more. They didn't include... they didn't include all the radioactive particles, the radioactive atoms. And I didn't click on that, I guess. But they didn't include the radioactive atoms, the buckyballs. And so to your left, you see the buckyballs, what I call a buckyball. That's a rough shape. And what it is they sprayed salt water on the reactors for the first 40 days, because what else are you going to do? And they never had no fresh water. Everything was busted up by the earthquake. You remember the earthquake? Hang on, I'll pop back to that earthquake for a second. And you can see how everything got picked up and busted to pieces. And so what happened was they sprayed salt water in on the reactors, and this sulfur peroxide urethol phenomenon where you create these little balls and they ingest the radioactive particles like the ones you see going around the world. That's a model of the dispersal. That's another model below it of the dispersals on North America. But it never stopped coming out for 7 months. This dispersal you're looking at is based over a 40-day model. Now, they do these models at the universities. They all had that same model. And so they put numbers in, and you only put the numbers in for reactor one. So you're only seeing the numbers for reactor one, and you're not seeing reactor one because I haven't got it imported because I'm a lazy, lazy man. And while we're chatting, I'm going to come over and see if I can fix that and get some redemption of number one. And I still haven't got everything organized. But since when did that ever stop me from trying? So we're looking for unit, hang on. The model they done it on was unit one. It's easily identifiable. And I'll find that picture in a break of a speed here. Do-do-do, unit one. Come on, buddy, where are you two? I got too many pictures. I'll have them all lined up tomorrow. I'm gonna get rid of everything I'm doing tonight, clean everything off, new slate, restart. Don't tell me I haven't got one. Oh, here's a good one. That's not going to work, dear Dana. Because, okay, let me keep going back to the old routine. And, I got to improvise, folks. Hang on. We don't get to see unit one. But I got to bring up an interesting picture anyway while I'm at it, and I'll jump back to what I normally do. Just a quick note, to your right is unit four. And to your left is unit four. Both of that is according to TEPCO, and both of that is according to the media. The one on the right is full of radioactive material from the detonations. That's unit four. But yet they show us the one on the left in the media. You can look up my site, Beautiful Girl by Dana. In a day or two, we'll tell you our .org site is looking pretty spiffy. You're going to like it. I guarantee it. Or you get your money back. Not that I cost you nothing. I can get my money back and get another one if you don't like it. That's what we'll do. If you don't like it, I'll go get another one. But I think it's really cool. Well, I still got some work to do on that. But the nuclear industry, obviously, if they're going to show you, you know, where one building can't possibly be inside of another building scenario, and I lost track of what I was doing, because that's what I do. I lose track of what I'm doing. This is unit 3 on the right, that's unit 2. Unit 2 is just as deadly in one sense as unit 3, because unit 2 had a lot of plutonium in it and probably had MOX fuel in it. The unit on the, that's missing to your right, the carnage, is unit 3. That was 3,450 assemblies. Each assembly has 80 nuclear fuel rods. Each fuel rod is around 12 feet. So inside of the 80 fuel rods in each assembly of the 3,450 assemblies is roughly around 280,000 nuclear fuel rods. Each rod weighs around 18 pounds. A single gram of it produces more radioactive atoms than all the radioactive particles on the planet. And not only is 3,450 assemblies with 80 rods that are 18 pounds each missing, which works out to 2.2 billion times more radioactive atoms than all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet. Now, if I liberated all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet, we probably couldn't see each other, because you have no idea how much sand is actually out there if you think different. And I dove 14 years as a commercial diver in boat oceans. There's 27,000 islands up here in British Columbia, 26,700. And these islands are covered in beaches, beautiful sand beaches. It would take you 71 years to explore every one of those islands. Which reminds me, I brought in some stuff about that, because that's what this tonight's subject was supposed to be about. I got to jump back to one more clip in a second here. I'll bring it up in the window, and we'll go back to Health Canada driving across Canada with their big planes and radiation detectors, and they detect it, and I'll come back to that picture after. So to finish off in the Health Canada plume study, right? Evidence of sharp features in the Fukushima plume over southwestern British Columbia. So they confirmed the plume, it was a snowstorm, and I'll show it to you. Here's their snowstorm, their modeling, that they never released to the public, and that came out a couple of months ago. This was taken March the 18th, March the 19th. You got to think about that. We paid them, we paid for the equipment, we paid for their pensions, we paid for their trucks, their credit cards, their vacations, probably their porno. We pay for it all because they steal all the time, and we don't care as long as they would do their job when the time came. That's the point. We understand. You get bored. And when the time came, they didn't tell us. Now, I don't blame them. Don't you either. That's a mistake. You blame the fact that they were shut down by Stephen Harper, who was licking Obama's boots, who enacted a national security legislation. And so these people want to tell you what happened, but they're worried about their pension, because they know if you find out what they've done, that they're not going to have no pension, and they very might well end up in a lot of trouble, and nobody's going to be happy if they're in trouble. I wouldn't be happy if I was in trouble. Would you be happy if you were? Dana, shut up and get on with it. Okay, so what you're looking at is the modeling from 18 hours of flying alongside the coast of British Columbia with Health Canada, and they were looking at, this was about the sharp features in a Fukushima plume. In the plume, it flew across the country. Now look in the second sentence. The Fukushima plume, right? See that one there, the second line? Provides nice opportunity to test radioactive detection capability. I got something you can't detect. It's everybody in Canada screaming at you when they see you driving down the road, when they find out what you've done. That you murdered them. You murdered everything they love. You destroyed their country. You never even told the institutions to go out and try to fix anything, to try to develop filters. And so you inundated everybody with an illness, with a sickness, including your loved ones and your friends and your families and your aunts and your nephews and your nieces and your brothers and your sisters and your cousins and everybody who thinks you're cool when you give them a tip, and everybody else on the planet, you betrayed them. Your time is now to come out and say, they made me do it. Here's the numbers, Dana. Bless your arse for getting out there and motivating mine. That's what we need. We need people to stand tall. You have to put your back against the wall. Do you think for one second what I'm doing here doesn't have a blowback effect on me and every aspect of my life, and won't till the end of time if we don't get this right? Do you think the rally and the fact that I can take the victories away from these folks? You know, let me see if you're smarter than a nuclear scientist. If I got a banana in one hand and a 12-foot nuclear rod in the other hand, can you tell the difference? Is a banana somehow different than a 12-foot nuclear rod? I don't know about you, but to me, it probably is. That's just me. But to a nuclear scientist, I don't know. It's a banana. It's a fuel rod. What do I know? I'm just a nuclear scientist. Huh? What am I supposed to do? I get paid not to say things. I'm paid to fill up a hole. So if the media shows up, I can say, hey, it's like a banana, right? Remember Buckingham Palace, John from Oklahoma, which got its own issues, saying about WHIP repository. I don't got a picture of WHIP for tonight's show. So that's okay. Let me get back on track because I won't shut up if I keep going down that road. But anyway, the second sentence. Now the third sentence. That third sentence. The study focuses on the arrival of the probe. That's a Health Canada study. Now yet, just a few days before that. Days after that, was it? Let me see. No, one more, Dana. You'll get it right sometime, Dana. Try one more time. Yeah, so the next month, so that was 2 weeks later, April 11th, 2011, Health Canada said, hey, it's only 300 times background level, Dana. Stop your whining. It's like a banana. It's like potato chips. It's like walking into the sunshine. And I say it's not. And I say that is a victory for everybody out there that in 8 months, after 70 years of listening to that jargon, we have taken away their ability to use it because people will slam them. People will pound them. People will annihilate that narrative and they know their jig is up. They can still get away for a while, but now that I'm back up and rolling, don't think if I catches the story, I ain't going to pop out a 2-minute video and make things right because that's what I'm going to be doing. It's all about making it right. It's all about bringing the reality to it. And I know you get all googly-eyed and say, oh, Dana, it's just the ocean. It's just the whales. No, it's more than that. It's way more than that. They're going to kill the lobsters. And I love lobsters. What are you going to do without lobsters? You tell me. If you like lobsters, they kill all the I don't like tuna. Frig the tuna. I don't care if they all die. They can all go out and die. I don't care about Tona, he goes out and eats. He's a big bully. He eats everything out there. He's nothing but a bully. But the lobsters, they mind their own business. They wait till something comes by, gets in their faces, then they beat it up and eat it. That's cool. That's righteousness. Okay, Dana. It's like the WHIP, you know. Let me just say, because I know I talked about WHIP, so I got to finish it. How can anybody say anything about WHIP besides the fact that they evacuated the WHIP repository in New Mexico for 9 days because they had a truck fire? They didn't go back down on Valentine's Day, 9 days after a truck fire, most dangerous thing on the planet. They didn't have to because there was a radiation release down there. So ask yourself, gee, you know, I wonder, nah, Dana, maybe, I don't know, just, maybe, I don't know, Dana. A truck fire could be pretty dangerous. I can understand not going back down in the mine for 4 days, maybe even 5 days, but 9 days because of a truck fire? Okay, 6 days. I'm pretty coward. I'm afraid of my own shadow. I pee in my pants all the time when I hear the dogs barking. It's the kooky nuclear apologists. They're going to come and take me away and lock me up. Because that's what I live like, right? There's a helicopter. It's a black helicopter. They're coming to spy on me. No, I leave my doors and windows open. Because you can't stop them if they come anyway. So I just don't care. And I'm not going to live in fear. I'll never live in fear. I'll never apologize for doing a moral and ethical thing. I'll never bow down and lick anybody's boots under any circumstances. Not even for an extra 100 years of life. I don't lick boots. You can't buy your dignity. And they all sold their dignity. Right? Look. April 4, 2011, California was on a radiation threat April 6th and 7th. That was April 4th. Now, these are headlines. You got to think about how Drudge Report works, where he just takes headlines of mainstream media and he puts it up on his site, but he doesn't put any context here. What E&E News does is he takes a paragraph. You go down a little further, there's another headline from another newspaper on the topic and another paragraph, and you click to that link and you go over and read the original article. And so they support the story, and that's all they're doing is just telling the same story by linking you over there, taking a paragraph. They're not sitting there, whoa, latest this forecast is all of California under radiation threat. No, that's academic peer review modeling from Finland, from Norway, from Sweden, from France, from America. Hey, what do you think that thing over here was? What do you think this is? That's America's models, both of them. Sorry? Yeah, well, because you're wireless, but we'll keep going. I haven't checked. How are we doing over here, folks? It's been a while, so it'll take a while for everybody to get back into motion. Let me refresh it. And we try to keep the momentum going. Sometimes it'll freeze up. We got a lot of bandwidth sucking out of here tonight. And I got audio on this one. Oh, sorry, folks. Let's keep going. So, here we go. Back to the buckyballs, American dispersal models over a 40-day period. I know I'm going to my Donald Duck voice the once here. But this is all, how do you talk about something so serious without trying to, you know, put in some kind of, something to keep the momentum going, right? So, I want everybody out there to really think about what I'm going to say to you for a second. I'm going to show you a picture, and it's hard to look at. But you have to sit there and you have to look at it because you need to really appreciate what all those radioactive particles mean to the ocean. And you remember the story of all the turtles washing up on a beach and their dogs would eat them and die. Here comes the picture. So this turtle or any turtle like it, that's the end of their history in the ocean because of the radioactive fallout, because of the way that it works on the ocean. You got to think about how radiation, I guess we get a lot of pixeling because I got to get the screen finished and the lights finished, folks. It'll take a few days. My hair looks like it's all shiny. I like that, actually. That's cool. I can live with that one. But when I get the rest of the lights, there'll be no pixeling of me. It'll be a really clean shot. And let me get back on track with everybody. Is I want you to think about Fukushima. There's three melted reactors, and I'll just give you a normal visual of those reactors. And I'm sure I got something here somewhere. Here we go. They're burning the debris. They're grinding it up. They're taking it out of prefectures, radioactive debris, and they're burning it. And so they're releasing up, and they're allowed to burn 100 to 300,000 becquerels a kilogram. Now, if you eat that, you end up with all kinds of cancers in a short period of time. That's distributed not only amongst the prefectures, but it's also distributed into the upper atmosphere, into the lower troposphere and the upper troposphere, which is an ocean, and it assimilates into the water. And that picture should have been down here, but let me keep going on that one. That's important to think about, is how the water, oh, I should have been this way, not that way. And that's supposed to be over out of the way. I forgot about that. I'm sorry, folks. We'll get around to that part after. I forgot about the microphone was going to show up in these clips. I should have had it somewhere else. But I still haven't got time. So it goes up to the upper troposphere, lowest troposphere, and then it gets assimilated into the water drops in the rain, and then it rains out. That's why that picture is important to you. And that's, once again, a lot of this stuff from what they're showing you was low altitude. So it wasn't just upper atmosphere, it was also the lower atmosphere was a storm, a snowstorm, sustained snowstorm for 8 months. Now, cancer doesn't happen overnight. And so a lot of people will try to poke fun at you. Well, I don't see millions of people dropping dead. Well, it takes 5 to 10 to 15 years for the man-made radioactive elements to manifest, the isotopes to damage. Now, the minute you ingest it, your body loaded up with white blood cells. And so the white blood cells are going to displace all the oxygen molecules in your blood, and you're going to feel lethargic. You're going to feel like you don't want to do nothing. Now, if you eat genetically modified critters and creatures, you got to remember that there's no nutrients left in it except for tiny parts per million. So, for instance, it used to be around 6,000 parts per million of calcium in a typical organic everyday corn on the cob. But the genetically engineering, instead of putting more calcium into it, they engineered it down to 114 parts per million. And so that's the equivalent of 428 corn on the cob, GMO, the beautiful looking stuff you see in your supermarket, versus a single organic. You would have to eat 428 in one meal to get the same amount of calcium. And then you would have to eat even more to get the potassium and the magnesium that you still would have got in the single organic corn on the cob. Now, that's just corn. Now, most of the food in your supermarkets is genetically modified critters. These are not indigenous to Earth. You won't find these critters in your periodic tables, in your solar system. These are man-made and they have a patent on them. They have a patent on them and they have exclusive abilities to control them. And they're not designed to engineer to sustain life. They're designed to cause life to perish, including insects. The ground gets saturated and contaminated. The root system, it becomes inhabitable zone, and it mutates the creatures there. And every farmer's field with GMO has to have a safe refuge for insects and animals and birds and bees even. And of course, the bees are becoming extinct. And I don't think it's quite because of anymore because of formaldehyde and glyphosate, which, by the way, is engineered into the DNA of your corn. It's engineered into the very... And so we'll have lots of sections into this wirecast. I'll be able to bring up the pictures of that stuff. But you see that plume behind me? That's Canada, North America. And I need that there as a visual from what I'm telling you and why I'm telling you that stuff. Is you have to avoid the genetically modified critters, like I always tell you, of course, because they don't have the nutrients and they have toxins and dioxins engineered in. You can't wash that off. And what that does is it fuels the cancers. And then it is also like you're popping your chocolate bars or aspartame. And that's just poop from bacteria that they got a patent on it from genetically modifying it. And then that's used as a sweetener. But that's also is the formaldehyde, the glyphosate, and the other carcinogens that they engineered into the DNA of your food that didn't exist before. Right? And Mothers Against America paid for those academic studies. And they showed that, you know, a single corn on the cob, you would have to fill up the back of a pickup, back seat of your car with corn on the cob right to the ceiling to get the same amount of nutrients that exist in normal food. So they engineered all the nutrients out of your food. That should be your first hint that the system doesn't have your best interest at heart. Now, it gets worse than that because that's most of that stuff that they created with no nutrients is what they made your dog food out of. It's what they're making your baby food out of. It's what your supplements are created. It's what most of your pharmaceuticals, unless you come from the right gene pool, they won't give you that. You'll be told never to buy that. And they have a cures and fixes for that. You got to realize that there's 4,340 peer-reviewed academic studies published every day. That's three a minute. This is a university. Each one of these studies is an institution spending tens of thousands and millions of dollars, not just on equipment that they need to do that with, but other institutions have to repeat those studies. And so every day there's 4,000 plus of these studies published and they're locked away in the ivory tower. And so we don't know what's going on. Fox News, CNN, MSNBC, BBC, it's a distraction. They don't tell you news. Real news, you have to go pay for it, a lot of money. But we give away the peer review studies to private corporations and they lock it away from us. And so that's the inherent twistedness of our society where imagine if we took 4,340 peer review studies tomorrow that were published and sent to all those institutions and students and professors and academics and deans that we want you to go out and solve the gas crisis. Here's your budgets like you had. You just published your studies. Great job. You got published. You're good to go. We want you to take our loved ones, our children. We'll pack their lunches. And we want you to stop that meteorite that's coming at us and going to destroy not only the Pacific Ocean because you're all interconnected. Right? So they all, and then all the maniacal stuff that they've done. You got to think about global warming, how that's shoved down your throat. Well, 15 container ships with 5,000 cargo transport truck containers on it. 5,000 of those on a ship. 15 of those ships is more pollution than all the automobiles on the planet because they burn what's left over from the production of petroleum products is supposed to be locked up as toxic waste. And so instead, it's only about 15% efficient. And so that's your acidification of the ocean in the upper troposphere and lower troposphere. And once again, in another sense, yeah, let me keep going. There's 90,000 of those on the ocean at any given time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, perpetual motion machines spewing this toxic 90,000. So you got to put that in multiplications. So that's equal to 42 trillion people, trillion, not billion, not million, but 42 trillion people driving automobiles every day on this planet. I breathe the air. I don't know about the air behind me anymore. I'm not very happy about that stuff. But you can see how crazy cool our planet actually truly is. It's sustaining this beating that we give it. That's global warming. That produces more pollution. That's 42 trillion people. That's the animosity equivalent. 42 trillion people on our planet every day. We're destroying our planet on purpose. They're destroying the planet with radiation in increments over decades. Not only from the dumping into the oceans, not only from the massive releases, the ongoing releases from Sellafield, England, where there's 8 million liters a day of radioactive from the MOX fuel plant, but it's not the melted cores, at least not that we know. We know there was a meltdown there. We don't talk about it very often, but there was a partial meltdown. We don't know how bad it is. They keep expanding the zone around it, and every time somebody says something, they blame it on radon, which is a pure... Now, that goes into the ocean, just like Fukushima, just like Hanford in Canada. Hanford has 450 billion gallons in the 40s, 50s, and 60s of extraordinarily toxic stuff dumped into the topsoil. Dumped it, not in barrels, but dumped. And now the 500 square miles is barrels. They got 41 miles of open pits that's not lined. A barrel's only going to last 5 or 10 years. It's going to disintegrate. We're talking about the most carcinogenic, the most caustic, toxic stuff on the planet imaginable. You know, that's why they have to build these sites to be such an amazing construction. It's just to try to keep contained at the melted core. They understand, right, that it gives them time to get it out of the way, but it can't stop it. You can't stop it. They threw